Hello, I'm Travis Cummings, the producer of How We See We, a real-time broadcast series. We got the opportunity to sit down with six different students of differing opinions and ideas to discuss some hot topic issues facing our country today.
My name is Tamiera Nash. I'm from New Orleans, Louisiana, and I'm 20 years old, and I classify or affiliate as a lesbian.
But my name, Crystal Hime Blair. From is a bit of a difficult thing. I was born in Germany and lived in seven different states in two different countries. I would say I'm not, well, by choice and not, part of the transgender community. So I identify as a transgender woman and a part of that sub-community. Below transgender and a part of the LGBTQ, and affiliate beyond that, I'm a writer.
I'm passionate about rugby because it allows me to be freer and be myself more than any other sport I've ever played, and I'm really passionate about, I guess some would call it being an activist in a different mode of my life. So feminism, LGBT community, black community, anything pretty much that I feel is being oppressed.
Mainly my novels currently, and more often than not, now into actually writing scripts for to actually write TV series. And mainly a lot of them actually end up dealing with a lot of identity and gender issues.
It's in my opinion that this conversation is probably going to get somewhat heated because me and myself are lesbian and arguing with someone who's also in or debating somebody who's in my community. It doesn't always go over the smoothest, especially when you guys have semi-opposing views, but it's something I am very much interested in discussing.
As I can tell right now, it's going to be very direct and just more informative. It just kind of gives an idea of who I am.
I feel like projects like these open up the room for dialogues. It opens communication. It allows people to get their points out and at least attempt to see the other side of the story and not focus so much on I, and maybe try and come to a consensus that'll be okay for the majority.
Giving a way for people to understand us, both sides, because in the end, the plights of one of trans women can be extremely different from trans men, because I could never speak for all the transgender community because we all are different. And that's the one thing I actually want to get across is none of us are, we all are not the same, just as much as no one else is the same.
For us, being in the bathroom of the opposite gender can actually put us in a position of various anxiety levels or even in danger, where I've actually read articles of transgendered women who actually have been attacked by people of the opposite gender. So in the end, this puts us, like, even when I actually started transitioning, where I was scared of what to do in the situation in Alabama because I didn't know how people viewed it, to where I actually at first went to restrooms of the opposite gender because a lot of women, I didn't know how people would judge me for finally doing what I felt comfortable where I needed to go. And it made me scared to go to the restroom because at moments when I was there, I had men stare me down or actually just make me feel as though I should be leaving. And at the same time, I had women who were scared of me going to the restroom, which put me in a position where for, I'd say, 4 to 5 weeks, I was actually scared to go to the restroom. I just went to restrooms that were out of the way. So in itself, it can actually cause great anxiety to where I feel as though this is bad for people who are transgender.
My side to that is, even though I kind of understand the usage of it and identifying as the person that you are or feel that you are when society tells you that's not how you were born and that's not who you should be, I wholeheartedly agree that you guys should be able to go to the bathroom that you identify with, but I agree after a sex change. I feel like once you've come to the place or the point where you say, I was born a guy, but I feel like I'm a girl, if you want us to look at you that way, take that initial step. Do what you have to do to be yourself. I don't necessarily agree with the concept of I identify as, but I'm not going to go through the change myself type of thing. I feel like if that's going to be who you are, that should be who you are, period. And through the transitioning stage, I know that everybody doesn't have the money to go and afford to change immediately. They have all these procedures and hormones and things that they have to undergo. But I feel as though in the meantime, it is a danger and a hazard to both parties in my own respective views. For you, you guys have the anxiety and you guys are threatened or you guys can go through who knows what just on the basis of you being yourself. But at the same time, on the other side of that, you have other people and how they feel about themselves and their identities as well that get called into question. So I feel like we have to take a moment. We have to look at it from all sides. We can't just say, oh, well, this group here is feeling, so the trans group one way is feeling, I can't go here and my anxiety levels and that they're unsafe, but at the same time, in a way, it's not necessarily maybe what you guys or what anybody is trying to do when they're just trying to be themselves, but we do have to look at it. There are people who would possibly take advantage of us changing the law and saying you can identify as whatever and go anywhere as you please. And even though I don't think that's the point, we have people in this world that'll just do it. It's just how it is.
But there's no factual backing on that stasis, though.
If you gave it a chance, you'd find it. Every time we, as a people, if you think about it, no matter how you look at it throughout history, if you go and change anything, whenever you change, there's a backlash. And in this backlash, we will have problems. So in the Black community, once the civil rights movement started and we started to try and like use the same water fountains, use the same bathrooms, sit at the same tables, people would just rather burn the building down and cause havoc and destruction for anybody rather than just let that group of people be comfortable. I'm not saying it's a problem that you, as the trans community, would commit or the problem that you guys will rise yourself as much as people who may be against you, as much as the pedophiles of the world, and I'm not at all putting that on the trans community's shoulders, but it's something that we do have to consider because people are messed up.
But that could be also about any social community too. That you're taking away rights from a people because of the bad people in the world. That could be, that's like you said, you use civil rights. There are people in the civil rights community who actually have done horrible acts. Like you notice gangs and other Black people in the Black community who actually committed atrocities, but didn't denote that everyone deserved equal rights. So why not of everyone of any gender be deserving of equal rights? Why does the community have to be punished for people who are unassociated with the larger community?
I don't feel like the denial of rights is something that is necessary, but I do feel like until there's a more concrete grounding and a way to prevent certain things like that from happening, it's a step we should make with caution.
It's caution without factual backing, though, because I've actually read more articles to where in the end it's just a grievance of fear of change rather than actually understanding the transgender community itself.
I'm not afraid of you guys. I'm not afraid of anybody within the trans community. I don't feel like anybody's out to harm me. But I feel like, are you really honestly willing to say that? You think that if we had this law change, pedophiles wouldn't feel as though that they had a right to go and be a lady one day and just go into the bathroom? You don't think that's possible? You don't think it's possible for people to take that law and run with it?
They could do it right now, though. There's nothing stopping them from doing it now. That's what's easily argued. There's nothing stopping them from doing it now.
Other than the fact that it won't be protected. They can't just go into court. They can't go into court and go, oh, well, the law says that I'm equal. They can't go into court and say that.
Nothing protects people. Like, you're saying that rapists and other pedophiles become protected under the law.
This doesn't protect anyone from doing illegal acts. This is just protecting people's right to just use a restroom.
If the law can't protect people from not being able to do something, then it's not protecting people who are being able to do it at the same time. I feel like if you said that you've been, or you have, or you use the women's restroom on campus?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Has anybody on this campus done anything to you because of that?
At first, when I actually have been stopped by administrative staff, where they question why am I even in there.
Was this while they were in there or this why I was you?
Yes, they had staff stop me for actually when I first transitioned, when I actually started using the women's restroom.
Did the school come up with a law for this? Did the school change something in the bylaws?
It had to be done by other schools, but the issue is like they had to actually teach the staff how it is that what transgender is and how to actually act.
So you don't think that we should teach the public first before we go try and slam laws and stuff down their throats?
The
The thing is, it's supposed to be done both ways, though, because there's nothing protecting us for our own rights, though, too. Because the thing is, certain states want to say it due to sex, but the thing is, it should be due to gender, because it's more on identity than it is, like, unless you want to post police officers, just like one state tried to do where no officer wanted, it seemed as though it's not probably that officers wanted to, is to go into bathrooms and check people's genitals just in order to use the bathroom.
No matter how much I think education may help, no matter how much the government may do, you will always, and we always run the risk of having those people who are against it for their own personal release. They're against it for their morals, their everything about them, or maybe not even everything, just the majority or the basis of who they are says this is not how it's supposed to be. People don't get to choose. You don't get to choose your sex. You don't get to choose your gender. You don't get to choose who your body's claiming that you should be with. Me supposedly supposed to be with a guy, not a girl, and all of it. No matter what, we run the risk of people being against us. And in all honesty, I don't think laws alone are gonna fix that. They don't fix what's in people's hearts. They can make you conform as best they can, but they don't fix it. In toleration versus understanding, toleration versus just acknowledging people alone is not the way. And I feel like a law is a toleration. I feel like it's not the government saying we back them. I feel like it's let's just get them off our backs. But at the end of the day, they can't make the states enforce the law. They don't.
I was going to ask if you could actually give me a moment.
Yeah, sure.
I was slightly scared of the other side, because it reminded me of other people previously who were literally trying to antagonize me, where I know I'd remind myself it was still a safe space, and she wasn't trying to, she was stating her opinion, but it still incited a fear reaction with me, which I wish... there are other public speakers who would know best to handle a situation where a person, when they actually verbally, passionately speaks from something versus me actually just recessing.
I was watching her facial expressions and trying to gauge myself and not be too harsh or too hard. And in some moments, I did feel as though I was getting out of place or going too far and then I should withdraw myself. But at the same time, it's those points in the conversation where you get the truth and you get the heart of somebody and you get your points. You get to hear the bulk and the base of the argument. And I feel like it's necessary. We can cry sometimes. We can hurt. We can feel it. But as long as you get up, keep going. It's okay. We should define the word tomboy, because I know in my sense, the way my mom put it, she would tell me I was dressed like a tomboy or I was acting like one when I'd be playing outside in the street with the guys and I had on my basketball shorts and a t-shirt and my hat to the back. That was just, for me, the basis of that.
A person whose gender is a woman who in the end expresses herself in masculine traits, mainly through clothing, clothing or actions.
I know from my own experience, I'm a female. I like to dress in men's clothing. I feel comfortable in that clothing. I don't know that I necessarily act as though I want to be a guy, but I know that I dress in that fashion. But I'm the more feminine behaving one in my relationship.
And just if you can, just to redefine, you don't need both action and clothing. It's just an identification of one or the other, because there are times where I've noticed people identify someone as a tomboy based only upon their action, but they could be in a dress or somewhat otherwise. And I've grew up with people who women who actually have been identified as tomboys, and in the end, it could even be on hobbies in general, too, that they would be doing.
That's all because of the community they may identify with.
I feel that's probably because we have these, like you said, societal norms, and we're used to men dressing this way and women dressing this way, and with people branching out and being more of themselves, and they're like, well, I feel more comfortable in guy or girl's clothing, and this is who I am, this is how I feel, this is what I should be allowed to be doing, so we do it. And then other people are looking, no, you can't do that, that's not right, take that off, put the dress back on, type of thing. And I go through that pretty much all the time, like whenever I go back home, my mom's like, let's go to church. I don't mind going to church. But then she's like, I bought this dress for you, and I guesstimated your size, and I think it, and I'm over here, but I bought this suit, and I like this, and I want it. And she's like, no, you weren't. This is not how you should be dressing. You are a girl. And personally, I feel like girl clothes versus guy clothes, and I feel like we gave clothes gender identities. And so in my mind, none of that matters, so to speak. Like, I feel like clothes are clothes. As long as they go on, they fit, and you don't look like a tacky person, then put them on.
Yeah,
and that's the same way I feel. Like,
but
any person can feel any, but certain styles or certain things, we feel attributed that actually do express ourselves. Like, we want every piece, like some people, and it's whether or not conscious or unconscious, we want to express ourselves. When our clothes go against our self-expression, we in the end have a self-image that conflicts with our actual internal image that we have of ourselves. And this is kind of, and that's where I feel like I advocate more people to express themselves however they want. And even with the rise of, like I've noticed more of the gender, people who are gender fluid or gender fluidity in general, that's where I've actually hoping for most fashion companies to actually go towards actually just advertising clothes. I want clothing to be denoted as expression. It is only expression. We only want to denote, because a lot of clothing denotes certain aspects where we try to actually denote like male, like we want to generate because we actually put certain dynamics around the clothing, but we can just put this as expression rather than gendered expression. Because of my clothing, I do not see why a man would not wear the same outfit. He could pull it off and I would not even question him. Just please do it right. And no, and please put on the right sizes. And we see these these public figures, but the issue is a lot of people that I feel end up being put as, being compared to them, rather than understanding that some people are just people.
Thoughts of suicide.
And that's what we tend to lose, is each person's still a human being. And a lot of people who end up being put a part of this action or this whole movement forget that some people aren't fighters. They aren't meant to be activists. They were just trying to live their lives in hopes that change can help them.
I want to be me and be me happily without the stress of a community on my back. But at the same time, you can't always just, some people can't just turn the blind eye when you know something's going on and it's not right. Like, I know they had the protest like last year when the year before last, when same-sex was approved, and they had it here, and I had to go. I just had to go. Why? Because it was a problem and it was affecting my community. I know within the black community, you have all of these faces popping up and all of these poets and these singers and people putting their hands up and everybody's doing everything that they saw done before, but it's not working. We need a pure leader, and that's the thing people... Nobody wants to be the head.
Like, you can never protest in your life, but people will associate it with you, and you take the repercussions just because you live. I would never ask anyone to do some of the things that civil rights leaders have done. I would not ask anyone to do some of the protesters that I've seen through history have done. If they are brave enough to do it, then they themselves, I would commend. But all the same, I would never ask it unless they actually do it. So the action falls upon those who are brave, not the general. Because those who are brave will send out a message to empower others to do what they need to do. Because I want to see a world where literally we actually understand each other a lot better. Because that's the first part of actually being able to love someone, is in order to understand.
Yeah, I feel like over time we'll be able to find a place where the LGBT community and every other community out here will probably eventually come to a consensus that we're all humans and we all deserve the right to be, to live, and to love, however we see fit.
I was expecting more of a calm dialogue than something that got heated, to where, for me, habitually I try to avoid actually being in a very heated conversation. I try to actually keep it calm, easygoing, and actually something where I feel like both sides can actually not feel like they would be scared of each other.
I really enjoyed that first one. I know it was kind of hard and it kind of felt like rough at some point, but I enjoyed her asking questions. I enjoyed her her passion about her points and her position. I like that she felt as though, even though she is a trans woman, that it didn't mean she had to fight the point through my head, but at the same time, she held her position, she held her place, and she kind of taught and showed me some things that I didn't necessarily understand at first.
There's a lot I can learn about me speaking, and a lot more I can appreciate about those who actually are out publicly.
I feel like it was a pretty nice, even discussion. I feel like at some moments I got my point across, and other moments I could have been a little more forward with what I thought. I partially feel like I was a little aggressive in some of the points that I made, and it may have felt like I was attacking her point, and in no way did I mean to do that, but I kind of wanted to clarify on some things that I had said, and I feel like through the clarification it kind of may have seemed aggressive. Pretty much for almost every question or prompt that we had after the first one, there was mutual understanding in what it was that we both felt, and that we kind of connected on some points to the fact that we couldn't really debate each other, because it was like, well, this is why I feel it. Well, I feel this too, and I guess it's the same thing. But overall, I feel like, yeah, it was pretty eye to eye.
My name is Becca Byrne. I am 21 years old, and I identify as independent, but I tend to agree with most Democratic policies.
My name is William North. I'm 21. I'm a Christian, I'm a conservative, and I'm a Republican.
I am passionate about justice and primarily in the political sphere about improving education and making it accessible and better for everyone.
Things. I'm passionate about my family. I'm passionate about my friends. Those two groups of people have done a lot for me in my life, so I feel it's my opportunity and goal to make sure that I take care of those people who have taken care of me. I'm passionate about the game of baseball. It's been with me ever since I was 5 years old. This will be my last year coming up this year, so it's bittersweet.
I think this conversation will be interesting. Obviously, me and my counterpart have different views, but I'm excited to learn from each other and to see what he has to say about what he's defending and the policies that he supports.
This conversation is going to go great. I don't see why it wouldn't. This is a couple badgers on the hill just having some nice, friendly conversation. I wouldn't expect anything different.
I think it's a learning process, not only for the two people that are talking or that are involved, but for everyone that is going to watch it and for everyone on the process listening, especially so close to the election cycle time, I think it'll really be able to educate people on some of the issues that we're talking about.
Everybody's got different stance, different views on the world. It's always good to hear what people have to say. Just get to know people and their background, how they perceive the world. Can see nothing but good things coming. Should be good.
I hope to learn something. I hope to learn something specifically from Will, who is going to be talking to me about his views. And I hope to walk away better prepared to defend my positions and to have a better understanding of the other side as well.
Just a good time to see where my other badgers stand, to get a better perception of the United States and where we are today and where we think we're going to be going in the future.
Yes, I grew up Republican in a very Republican household. I started questioning, you know, why am I identifying as Republican when I don't really know what the policies are or why I'm believing that. And then when I started looking and educating myself on political issues and wider in the political sphere, it became clear that I'm not Republican, and I definitely cannot just associate with what my family believes.
Nothing's really made me question what I value. As far as like in a negative way, things have only made me realize the stance that I take is a good stance, and I'm happy and I'm proud of where I'm at right now. Well, my preferred candidate is Donald Trump. I think what will ensue is a stronger nation.
To me, as a bystander,
I think we'll make America great again.
I'm extremely nervous.
I hope to make America great again.
In the White House,
I think we'll find more of a united country. I think we'll find more conservative views for this nation. And I think overall we'll find ourselves in a better situation than we are now.
Nice. I think if Hillary Clinton is chosen, who I'm supporting, she'll continue the work that Obama has been doing for the past 8 years. She's a little more bipartisan than Obama, so I think I'm looking forward to seeing more working together with Republicans and Democrats across Senate and Congress. I think the reaction for either one of the candidates is going to be pretty pretty large. There's gonna be a big reaction on either side. So I'm interested to see how people are gonna unite and come together after that, because at the end of the day, this is about a one country and one nation coming together. So despite the differences, you know, it'll be interesting to see how people get behind that, I think.
I think there's no problem, I'll be honest with you. I don't think there's any problem. Where I come from, gun control means how well can you shoot your rifle? What's your target on something that's 200 yards away? I don't really think that this country has any problems as far with guns. Yes, could, you know, getting a gun be harder to get? Yeah, absolutely. My biggest fear is that if Hillary Clinton is elected, that she will try to take guns away from people. I know that sounds like radical and way out there, but it is potential. And, you know, once she gets in there, if she gets into the White House, she gets the Supreme Court, she gets some lefties behind her, and next thing you know, like, guns could be going off. But the problem is if you make a law or anything against guns, people who obey the law will obey it. And so if you take guns away from law-abiding citizens, people who don't obey the law, the criminals, will still have the guns, and then you have law-abiding citizens with nothing in their hands, right? The Second Amendment, we all have the right to bear arms. Mm-hmm. Whether that means whoever's coming at us has a spoon, then we have the right to fight back with a spoon. In this case, they're fighting back with guns, right? The government, the military, the police officers, they all have guns. Any enemy, somebody knocking on your door, somebody trying to attack you is most likely going to have a gun. So you deserve the right to have that gun as well to make it an even match. Mm-hmm. I just don't necessarily think that attempting to get rid of guns or trying to put a super, you know, just tight cover over guns is the way to go. I stand with Donald Trump on here where he says we're not going to touch the Second Amendment, period. Like, we're going to leave the Second Amendment as it is. For example, there's a town in Georgia called Kennesaw, and it's got 30,000 people population. Mm-hmm. In the last 14 years, there have been 3 murders by guns, and there have been about 6 murders in the town of 30,000 people in the last 14 years. Kennesaw, what they do in their city is they require that every head of household owns a firearm just to protect themselves and protect their house, protect their family, protect their welfare. Mm-hmm. You know, you look at some place like Chicago where murders by guns happen all the time, you're not allowed to have a gun in the city limits. Like, mm-hmm. Look at the facts. If you're not allowed to have a gun and law-abiding citizens don't have a gun, criminals are still going to have guns and you're still going to have problems.
Right.
So I'll gladly give away my guns if all the criminals turn theirs in too, which is never going to happen. So if anything, you might as well put a little tighter regulation, but you can't get rid of guns. You just can't.
So, well, a couple things. In America, so I do think there's a gun problem. I think there's a problem when you have more shootings happening in a year than there's days in the year so far. I think that gun culture has become dangerous, and that it definitely needs to be controlled in some way. I know that Donald Trump has said multiple times, like just watching some interviews and stuff, just in the news, that he said Hillary Clinton wants to take away guns. She does not want to take away guns. I just want to, you know, throw that out there. I'm from Texas. I really believe in the Second Amendment. I believe in my right to own a gun. I believe in my right to shoot a gun. I believe in all those rights. I want to do that safely. Hillary Clinton is advocating for comprehensive, common sense gun laws. You know, it is true that when you go into a store to buy a gun, you have to pass a background check. They can run it. The FBI does it in under like 9 minutes. You get your gun, but there's no background checks required at like gun shows, online purchasing. And I think, I think there should be stricter regulations for that. I don't think you should just be able to go online or go to a gun show and then not check your age or background check you before getting that.
You know, they're not weapons designed to kill people, right? Like, it's like saying a fork is designed for you to get fat, right? Like, if you abuse it, right, like, yeah, something like bad could happen, right? But a gun is only a weapon when it's in war. And I mean, there are guns. Most of these people going to gun shows, they're not going to buy a gun and be like, who am I gonna go kill next? No, they're saying, let me go get a long distance rifle. Let me go get this, you know, blah, blah, blah here to go knock out, you know, a doe, go get a buck. Let me go get a shotgun so I can kill some ducks. You're not really gonna have a criminal walking into a gun show, I don't think, going in saying, let me go get a handgun so I can go kill somebody.
I think it's kind of crazy that in the United States, it's easier to obtain a gun than it is to adopt a pet, or it's easier to get a gun than it is to get your license. You know, I think about when you get your driver's license, you have to take a test, you have to pass a class, you have to take a course, because driving in a car is potentially dangerous. When you have a gun, that is a weapon that is designed to kill people. I think at least you should check to make sure that the people that are going to be owning those are responsible and are safe and in a healthy position to do so. But I think the problem is right now there's a lot of unqualified people getting their hands on guns through laws that are not enacted in the United States. And it's been a problem. There's been more shootings this year than there are days, and people are dying. And I think that it would greatly benefit everyone in the United States if we could just have some common sense. You gotta at least have pass background check in every respect.
When you have all these killings, right, and more days than there are in the year, clearly, like, who just, you know, you gotta think about the people who wake up in the morning, like, you know, I'm gonna go have a gun with me, I'm gonna go kill somebody, right? Like, whatever happened to just waking up in the morning, going to work, like, getting your pay, like, you know, we need to make sure that these people who do have guns, these criminals, or just these people in these places where gun violence is real, like, we need to give these people some jobs, give them something to do, try to get guns out of these towns, and as far as, like, the illegally, right? But I do firmly, like, believe that every head of household should own a weapon, considering in Kennesaw, Georgia, literally 4 murders by death of weapon, of gun, in the last 14 years, because every head of household owns a weapon. Mm-hmm.
So Clinton's position on trade has obviously flip-flopped a little bit. The Trans-Pacific Partnership and NAFTA, she has both been highly critical of, and at other points has been more positive of. Right now, which I believe is going to be her stance as president, she is saying that she wants to kind of halt trade, have a trade prosecutor look into the trade agreements, and work to make NAFTA or a new trade agreement work for labor protections and environmental protections. I think free trade is good for the economy. Most economists agree with that. I think that TPP and NAFTA are good agreements. They have the right sentiment, the right idea. I'm not sure that the specific, like the way that it's going to be implemented is going to benefit us and offer more security. I think there's a lot of problems with manipulation and competition throughout the world, and we have to be careful moving forward with any trade agreement. So I think when she comes in, she's gonna have us take a step back. You know, TBT is about to pass. Potentially, she could be the voice to let that pass or not.
We've lost many, many jobs through our poor trade deficit that we've had for many years now. And I think with him creating more American jobs, he's just trying to increase American wages and reduce his trade deficit. I don't really think it's a necessarily bad thing to put tariffs on things. Yeah, if you're going to put a drastic tariff, yeah, that could be a potential problem. A slight tariff to just get Americans to want to buy American could be potentially
45%, it's kind of big numbers, though. I mean,
no, I'm saying, yeah, that might be a big number, but yeah. I'm saying it's also not bad to just buy American and get more jobs in America, create more wages in America. It's, like, unbelievable the fact that all of the trade deficit, and, like, when you talk about Clinton, when she was talking about one of these things we just read, you know, with her stances, how it changes, all this stuff with Secretary of State, like, that makes me super nervous, right? Like, I have a fact here where it says, President Obama predicted that the trade deal with South Korea would increase our exports to South Korea by more than $10 billion, resulting in 70,000 jobs. Sounds great. It says it killed nearly 100,000 jobs. Our exports to South Korea haven't increased at all, but their imports have surged to more than $15 billion, more than doubling our trade deficit in that country. That's a fact from the White House. Mm-hmm. Like, that just makes me super nervous that, like, A, we're not taking care of ourselves and we're, like, relying on other countries, and these other countries are literally screwing us over and we're falling even more and more into trillions of dollars of debt. Mm-hmm. And I think Trump, if Trump comes in with his background of being a good businessman, I think he will be able to turn this deficit around through his ways and his policies. He's got a seven layer policy. And I think he's able to get more money in America, lower this trade deficit, get more jobs in America, get America more productive. And the more productive a country is, the better it is. So I just think as long as you keep the jobs in America, I think we're a better country.
Okay, but with the tariff policy specifically, are you worried about competition becoming too strong or trade wars ensuing between Mexico and China?
I mean, not necessarily. I don't think a trade war is not going to happen overnight, right? Like, it's going to be something that's going to be built up. But honestly, I don't know too much about this tariff that they're going to be you know, potentially putting on if he gets elected, but I'm just backing American Jobs. But I don't see, if it's gonna get blown out of proportion, I'm sure it would be something that could be fixed before a trade war happens, right? Nobody's looking for war. Mm-hmm. If you can prevent a war, you're gonna prevent it. So I'm sure if there was something that was gonna go down, they would fix something, but I don't know. We'll see how drastic if a tariff happens, but I don't see anything drastic as a tariff war happening overnight.
So, I mean, it would take some time for, you know, him to get Congress to pass that and to have that actually put into action. You know, I do worry if that happens, you know, if countries only start buying their own country's products, then that definitely limits competition between other countries, which we need to have a more global economy. It also makes me a little nervous about the stability of America in terms of, like, our relations with those countries because, you know, Mexico relies on us to trade and have that good relationship and buy and sell and use their products. We do the same for them. I worry that if we just start doing everything domestically as a result of the tariffs, then our stability and relationships with those other countries could not be as good.
But are we going to keep worrying about relationships with other countries when they're literally kicking our butts and just literally taking a ton of money and a ton of American jobs? We keep coming up with programs where we think more American jobs, more wages, all these great things are going to happen, yet we keep just getting our butts handed to us by other nations. Like, I don't really think that's the way to go, right? It says America has lost nearly one-third of its manufacturing jobs since NAFTA and 50,000 factories since China joined the World Trade Organization. So I think if you're able to rely on yourself, that's better for you, right? Like, But if we're going to sit here and worry about relationships when we're literally losing billions of dollars and billions of jobs, we got problems.
Yeah. I mean, I personally do think that America should become more individualistic in terms of trading and economic policy and just environmental issues. Everything should be more individualistic. In terms of how other countries view us, though, I think that's something to consider just because America is the best, I think, world power that exists.
But it is depleting.
Definitely.
It is depleting because we're depending more and more upon other nations and we can't withstand ourselves and we're a ton of debt. We got a lot of problems.
But We need that competition to grow, though.
We've got bad trades going on. We're getting our butts handed to us. We're losing money. We're not that power that we all thought we were back in the day, and it keeps getting more and more proved as the days go by how weak we are and how divided we are as a nation. She does want to continue his legacy, though, correct? Right? Like,
I don't think she's not nearly as liberal as Obama. I don't think she's gonna do the same things as Obama. I think she's gonna work to make it as bipartisan as possible to reach as much common ground as she can.
Do you trust her carelessness?
I have questioned Hillary Clinton's judgment. I think that at the end of the day, she's smart and qualified and can make intellectual decisions that are right for the country. Yeah, I mean, I think both candidates this year, kind of pathetic. I think personally, they have a lot of flaws. At the end of the day though, Hillary Clinton is beyond qualified. She's educated and everything politically. Donald Trump is not. He has spent the last however many years as a reality TV show star and he incites a lot of violence and racism and recently was a tape condoning sexual assault. So I don't want that kind of person as my president or in the White House representing the best country in the world.
We think the best country in the world. But the problem with that is, right, if you're talking about all these personal instances of Donald Trump, right, like, but all these instances of Hillary Clinton are all while she's at work, while she's in the office, like, you know, disgracing her job, right? Like, the stuff that Donald Trump's done, these tapes and stuff, that was in the privacy of a car, right? Like, all these other things. Okay, but he wasn't at work, was he? Right? I've done a lot of crazy things on my way to work, too. The one thing that I really enjoy about Donald Trump is that he says it as it is. Right, of course. But would you want an honest person over a careless person? I think that, you know, as simplified as you can put it down, I feel way more comfortable as an honest person who might say some stupid stuff, like I'm saying a ton of stupid stuff on this show right now, than someone who's careless, who could potentially, you know, make bad choices and keep dividing this country or just keep making it weaker as we've progressed weaker in the wrong direction. And I think Donald Trump's trying to turn it back around and get the wheels back on the bus and get it going.
I just think it's problematic when you have a president who influences how a lot of people think and how a lot of people view other nations and ourselves. And I think it's problematic when not only has he behaved inappropriately, but when he... Okay, but he forfeits that when he becomes president. And the thing is, if he's acted and said things in public that are inappropriate, that's not going to stop just because he becomes president. And when you have a figure like that influencing especially kids, people watching that on TV, I think it's very dangerous for the future of America.
We have the same lady whose husband got in trouble in the White House, who they're still a family and still married. I mean, nothing's really as real as it seems anymore, right? That's why this election in general is a very big toss-up, right? Because, and honestly, as we progress and we get older and we live in this 21st century and media gets bigger and bigger, nobody's going to be the perfect candidate, right? Because everybody can find some little wrong thing about you and go find something to put on this and that. And ever since the TV was created, right, with Kennedy and Nixon when they were televised, the presidency has not been as respected as it used to be back in the day. And as media progresses, respect levels, especially with the presidents, are going to get lower and lower, in my opinion. Because you're always going to find one little thing, and he said, she said, and all this stuff. But at the end of the day, who's going to get the job done? You think Hillary Clinton, I think Donald Trump. Go America.
We'll see what happens.
We'll see.
I think me and Becca had a really good conversation. I think, in my opinion, we were both able to get our point across. We both saw where each other stand and say our opinions, and then also to listen to one another.
I think I was effectively able to communicate my main points. Yes, I think so.
Well, we were able to find our common ground and where we stand differently. We were able to find our common ground and a few of the points like safety and even gun laws. So that was interesting. It was interesting to see how much we have in common after thinking so much that we'd have stuff that we'd be opposed and different.
Well, I really appreciated just getting to hear Will's side, and I liked getting to say mine as well, and I think that I got to have a better impression of where Trump supporters in general kind of stand on a lot of issues and just how they're thinking about things and the way they're framing it in their minds, yeah. I think we agree on similar things. I mean, we want the same things, we just have different methods on how to get there. Obviously, we disagree across a large variety of topics and policies and how they should be implemented. But I think as a whole, we want America to be a great country, to be safe, and to be on top as a world power.
I thought it went really smoothly. I know I respect Becca, and I know she respects me, and I thought we had a pleasant conversation.
Well, things I wish I could have brought up that I didn't. But the topics were narrow enough to, there wasn't really enough time to bring in other points that would lead me to contributing to voting for Hillary Clinton as opposed to Donald Trump.
Just kind of wish we would have been able to talk a little bit more about some other topics. You know, I thought we had a good thing going. I didn't think we needed to end it.
There's gonna be different opinions politically no matter what. I really am glad that we were able to sit down and, despite our differing opinions, be able to have a respectful and really communicative conversation. I think that's important, and I think a lot of America has lost sight of that and having mutual respect for each other.
It's interesting to see how much we had in common, and I think as a country we need to see that we're all Americans and that we all need to come together, and so we all need to find that common ground within each and every one of us and come together to make America great again. And it was good, and I'm gonna take away with me that I thought, you know, coming in here that we'd have a lot of differences and disagree on a lot of things, but it was interesting to see how much we actually had in common.
I think that people will watch this and be like, oh, you know, people not fighting for once about political issues. I think that could hopefully elicit some conversation that is not as emotional, a little more calm, and able to focus on the issues as opposed to screaming who's right and who's wrong at each other. I think we've been seeing that, and there's been a lot of fiery debates, so I think this was a really great medium as a way to introduce topics and incite conversations that are less emotional and more reasonable.
We should all have respect for one another, so if you have two people who have respect for one another like we all should, you're gonna have peace, you're gonna have a peaceful dialogue. This was definitely, you know, interesting and definitely a good thing, I think, for what's coming. Make sure we make America great again. God bless America. Thanks.
I'm Jamal Ankelad. I'm 21 years old. In terms of my stance on race relations, I like to believe I stand with the side of justice and equality.
My name's Kiara Williams. I'm 20 years old. I'm African American, And my stance, I guess I'm a pretty neutral party.
I'm passionate about change because we know it's coming. We know it's inevitable. And so it's a question of how are we going to affect change? So the possibility of change itself means hope. And I think that's always a good thing, to have hope and change.
I'm passionate about helping others and making a change in the community. That's why I plan on being a teacher in the future.
People can have so many complex stances on issues. So I'm hoping that Kiara and I walk away still friends.
I suspect it will be full of high tension, a bit of hostility, but hopefully I'll be able to handle it.
And I think the real change isn't in not talking about something and hoping it goes away. It's about having open, respectful, honest, and thoughtful dialogues. And it requires a lot of active listening. So I'm hoping that I can do as much listening as speaking.
It would probably be very beneficial to those who are unaware of what's going on, and just being able to hear both sides of the story will probably help everyone learn to get along.
A mutual understanding of where we are, where we've been, and where we can go.
Understanding why everyone is on what side and how to educate the other side on where they stand, and just coming to a common accord on those two matters. As a Black female, I feel like ever since these have been occurring, I've been looked at differently in stores. So that's changed. But how it's being handled in media today could be handled differently, or you could see more change, which we haven't been seeing since each killing. Usually justice isn't served. So that's something that the country's battling with.
For me, it's kind of alarming how numbing it is now. So when I used to hear about it, like, I would get emotional, I'd get goosebumps, I'd be angry. But unfortunately, I think we've been so desensitized to it. So not only these instances where police killed unarmed men and women, but also just like how media portrays violence in general. So how we cover the Syrian war, how we talk about refugees and boots on the ground. So we've like objectified people so much that these are more statements than they are people. And so even in the Black Lives Matter movement, it's unfortunate, but we have to politicize these experiences and these lives. And I think that's what's really sad. So we can't reflect on them as Philando Castile. It's hashtag Philando Castile, you know what I mean? And so that's we're remembering them in a very dehumanized way. But it's just tense for me because you have to in a weird way. And that's what motivates people to move. And so the killings aren't new, it's just the recordings are. Like, I'm sure you've heard that before. And it's social, and so it makes me wonder how many times, this is happening right now. Right, but it might not be in the city that would get a lot of viewers that major mainstream news outlets care about, right? And so Baton Rouge, it was the capital. If it were New Orleans, it would have happened. But what about Shreveport, Louisiana, or like La Place, or like Monroeville, Alabama? Would the outrage be the same for these smaller circuits? And yeah.
And then just to think that without social media on our side, how long has this been occurring that we don't know about? So, shame.
I think it's pretty simple. I think all lives matter is ridiculous. And I don't think the people, I'm not going to be Hillary and put them in a basket of deplorables, but I think the people who say all lives matter, I think some are very aware of what they're doing in terms of attempting to silence the Black community from saying this is happening. And then I think some people think in a very like neo-hippie way, like we're all one. And it's that Black Lives Matter acknowledges that. And so I think when you really think about it, to say all lives matter because we're all one race, that's what Black Lives Matter is saying. It's saying we're all one race, but the system is showing us that our lives matter less. So it's a reaffirmation of that. It's like, hey, we're reminding y'all while we're all being one race that our lives still matter. Because in U.S. history, That's not the case. Of course, you have slavery. Then after slavery, you have voter suppression and Jim Crow and segregation. Then after that, you have mass incarceration, the war on drugs, the militarization of police, discrimination. We didn't get the GI Bill from the New Deal, things that created the new middle class we were barred from. And so we have never really been given a chance to succeed. And that's going to sound weird. Not saying black people can't be successful, but I'm saying in terms of resources being allocated and systems making way, whether it's the wage gap for black women and white women, whether it's the wage gap for women and men, we have always been an extra minority and we've always been held back from things. So to say all lives matter, well, I need you to protest job discrimination. I need you to be out there for trans women. I need you to be out there for Syrian refugees. I need you to be out there for the death penalty. I'm sorry.
No, please don't. For me, I understand where you're coming from, and I feel that certain people, they may just not be educated themselves on what each stance really represents. So I feel like someone on the outside looking in would be like, oh, all lives matter. It would be everybody, like, why are we focusing on that? But I mean, like, now, like, we were the first ones, you know, to start this movement, right? So then it's like we're actually finally sticking up for ourselves and getting out there, and it's like they're just shutting that down and be like, oh no, you know, how about we just talk about this and not that? So I mean it's something we're battling, you know, with. But I'm liking the movement, what's going on. I'm liking the change and we're seeing. And now everyone's starting from like such young ages now. So like we're really starting to really step up to the plate and like make a change for ourselves. Because if we don't do it now, when will it ever be handled? And then history always has a way of repeating itself. So we're about to end it now, hopefully. So, I mean, I feel like this progression will hopefully change things for the better, which of course, this is for the better. Will I ever think it will be 100%? I don't really know if I could say that right now, but it is steadily moving. From the town that I live in, back at home, I know there's this school, right, where they say that no black people can go to. And so, like, it's just been understood. So, like, once we know, like, there used to be white kids that used to go to our school, and then when that hit a certain age, they leave. Their parents pull them out of the public school and put them in that private school, and it's just like, oh yeah, it's no big deal. So I know moving here, it was a great like difference. I felt accepted. So I mean, maybe it was just a different thing where it's like being in a small town that whatever their animosity is can change, like stay the same. So like here being in a city, I feel like I've had chances to actually move up in the ladder. I'm able to have my voice heard. I'm able to make changes, differences, which I really appreciate. But going back from here to there, it's just like, why is everyone stuck like this? So, I mean, maybe I have to be that voice, but I don't know if I really can right now. I don't know if I'm at that moment in my life to do that. But society is trying. Well, some people in society are trying to make that progress, but some people, again, are having our voices quieted or hushed. So, I mean, we're always constantly dealing with something. But all in all, I think progression is being made somewhere.
We still have a lot more room for growth. What's interesting is, in the like American experience, we tend to think about progress in racial terms. So it's not a black-white thing. It's a gender equality thing. It's a trans rights, gay rights thing. It's even a children's rights thing. Like, we have most children living in poverty, and like nobody talks about that. And so we've made progress in a lot of ways. In a lot of ways, we've regressed. And one of those ways is we don't like opposite opinion. We live in a very polarized time. So if you say Black Lives Matter, you're against the police. And if you agree with Colin Kaepernick, you're not supporting our troops. And so we I don't know, that's what's scary. We America used to be great, so I've been told, because you could have so many different opinions and still function and have a functioning democracy. But now it's like, if you're not Republican, you're Democrat, and it's weird, honestly. So yeah, we've progressed, and in a lot of ways we're regressing. So I think the first thing is people don't understand the difference between like being prejudiced, discrimination, and racism. And so, I don't know how you're gonna take this, but people always look at me crazy when I say this, but Black people and people of color can't be racist, because that's not how racism works. Can we be prejudiced? Yes. So we can have beliefs that are based on stereotypes about people. Can we be discriminatory? Yes. We can act on those prejudices by saying, we're going to bar you, we're going to make you feel isolated. Can we be racist? No, because race is a system of power based on like something that's phonetic, right? And so for institution or something to be racist, I have to be in a powerful position based on my skin color to put you in a less powerful position based on yours. So that being said, only white people can be racist, because the system of race only benefits white people since it's their system, right? Because like that wasn't a thing before. White people were like, hey, I just feel like we should probably categorize the world in this way. So that's one thing that we have to look at. So this whole reverse racism is false.
I just want to go on to the next one. You handled that.
I'm so sorry.
No, it's fine. I like it.
We just need to get, like I said, get people to understand that our oppressions are intertwined. And like Dr. Martin Luther King said, an injustice somewhere is a threat to justice everywhere, or something along those lines. Like, we have to realize that, because we're a nation of precedent. That's how our legal system is set up. And so one thing I found interesting was the national body of the Church of God in Christ Incorporated, they intentionally went to hold their conference in North Carolina. So, you know, like Bruce Springsteen, other artists, and the NBA took their All-Star game from North Carolina because of their HB 12 discrimination bill. So this church body, which my family happens to be a part of, they intentionally went there and they held a press conference. And so what was interesting about that to me is, as a majority Black church religious organization, they are supporting this blatant discrimination against trans individuals. And in a legal system based on precedent, my argument is not against their religious values, because I think you have a right to, if your religious text says this, believe it, do what you want. But from a legal stance, you're supporting Black religious organization, you're giving the state the right to discriminate against trans individuals, right? So 6 months from now, a legislator in North Carolina can come back and say, well, we also want to ban Muslims from using a restroom too, because they might be building bombs in there. And so everyone's gonna say, you can't ban Muslims. And the state's gonna say, whoa. The precedent of discriminated against people has already been set. And so then now the case has a point, a legal case, to discriminate against Muslims. And after they do that, they're gonna say, well, crime in urban cities is going back up. Bathrooms aren't safe either. So now we want to ban Black people from using the restrooms again. We want to segregate restrooms. Well, you can't do that. Well, you were fine with it when we were discriminating against trans individuals because of the safety of our children. You were fine when we're discriminating against Muslims because of the safety of our nation. And so now we're trying to protect our cities. You can't use restrooms in public spaces. And we're SOL now, because the precedent of discriminating against someone has been set. And so we're so busy worrying about how I'm uncomfortable by someone else's experience that we don't realize that we're just opening the gate for other forms of discrimination. And I think that's how the races help one another. That's how the different sexual orientations help one another. All of our oppressions are tied. Me being poor is a problem for you as an educator, right? You don't think so, but if I'm poor, I don't have the resources to make your job easier. You now have to work 10 times as hard to meet me where I am. And you don't have the patience, you're underfunded. And so it's like all of our things are tied together and we don't realize that. And that's why we can't move forward. But yeah, I'm just a college student. I don't know anything.
Okay, so right now I feel like everyone's like bonding together with their own race and not coming together. So I mean, it would be wonderful if like everyone who feels disadvantaged would come together and do something like that. So I mean, but right now we just have to work out our own personal problems, I'm guessing. So what I'm trying to say is, because I'm trying to be as clear as I possibly can, so instead of everyone having their own movement matter, their own like insert race here, I feel like as like minorities, if we know that we're being pushed down, instead of pushing other like minorities down further and like maybe me move up, let's just all move up together as one. But I feel like that's something that we're harping against, like, oh, I'm better than this minority. So I mean, that's just something that we're not covering that. It's just like this one's worse than that one. But instead of harping on who's better off without this person in our community, maybe just come together as a whole. But I mean, I don't know if other people would see it in that way.
I don't consider myself an activist, but by the definition, I guess I would be. So as I've grown in my activism, I've become more like early Malcolm before his trip, his pilgrimage to Mecca, and less like Dr. King. I used to be Dr. King. But Dr. King's quote about integrating, I wasn't Dr. King. I used to have the same philosophy as Dr. King or a similar philosophy. And I think about his quote where he says, I fear I've integrated my people into a burning building. And so I say, I feel like I've become more like Malcolm, an emphasis on fear, because my focus is less on bursting bubbles of privilege. I'm not trying to get white allies anymore, because towards the end of his career, Dr. King was very strategic, and the whole career he strategic, and his strategic plan was, we're going to get them to create precedents. So you acknowledge that I should be able to drink from the same water fountain as you. You acknowledge that I should be able to sit wherever I want on a bus. You acknowledge that I should have equal access to education, blah, 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 blah. And towards the end of his career, before his assassination, he was focusing on economic equality. So he had gotten the government to set a series of precedents. You acknowledge that I'm equal enough to have access to all of this stuff. So where's my piece of the pie financially? Because while segregation was bad in terms of ethically and morally, one thing that you can't deny was the fact that Black America thrived. We had to own our own businesses. We had to keep our own communities up. So property value was higher, which meant our public schools had more resources. And so what happens to integration? You have these multinationals run by white families who can offer you a cheaper price. Am I going to pay $6 at Walmart, or am I going to pay $8.50 at this local Black-owned shop, right? And so when integration happens, by default, people who are already underprivileged and underserved are going to go with the cheaper option. So Black businesses can't thrive when Walmart and Costco can offer a much cheaper price in a larger quantity, right? And so I say that to say, would it be so bad to stop focusing on trying to get this wholeness and focus on the reality? Because I think in order for what we want to happen, like Marx, there will have to be a bloody revolution, because people in power are not going to give it up. History shows you have to take it. The underserved, the lower classes always take power, but we're too civilized for that in America. So is it so bad if we just say, you know what? Because the reality is, we're not asking for revenge, we're asking for justice. We want the ability to determine our own destinies, right? There are, right now on this set, there are 3 Black men. Statistically, one of us are going to go to jail. You line up 17 white guys, only one of them are going to go, right? And so what I want is, I'm not saying change the legal system. If I do the crime, I should pay my time. But don't give me minimum sentencing, right? Don't give me more time for the same crime than my white counterpart, right? That's what I want. I don't want your spot at Harvard, because I can get it myself. Just make sure my public schools are funded so I have the equal opportunity as you, right? Don't hide in your private schools. Allocate the resources equally so we don't need private schools. Because if I'm really as inferior, if I'm really as barbaric as you say, give me the best of everything. because I'm going to fail anyway if I'm everything you say I am, right? And so that's why I think it's very intentional, gerrymandering, right? And how we built the interstate system and how we do voter registration IDs. It's very strategic. There's power in minority voices. So is it so bad if we stop trying to get them to give us stuff and we got our own first, right? Black America has a spending power of $1.6 trillion. That's bigger than most small nations, right? If we took that money, then Nike would be like, wait, maybe Black lives do matter. So these politicians I'm paying to keep rubber low in these other countries, maybe I need to tell them to reform our justice system, right? Walmart's like, wait, all my workers are boycotting? Wait, okay, I don't believe it. I still think their lives don't matter, but now my business, you hurt my pockets. And now my board's upset. So is it so bad if we stopped trying to beg them for stuff and we just got our own, I'm about to curse, our own stuff together? I don't know, like, what do you think? I wanna be sure I'm not crazy and I'm not like.
I feel you, I understand. I know recently when I looked into the media to go against prejudice, or like, how do I say this? Well, it was at some school out west where it was a dorm. They were having the white people who were living in that dorm didn't feel comfortable when everything was rising up, so they were going against their black counterparts. So instead of those black people staying in that hostile situation, now they worked with the school to have an all-black housing facility. So now some people are looking at that as, well, that's going back to how it used to be. They're going to now have all white and all black housing situations. So now people are like, no, but then it's just like, well, they got out of that situation where they're like, I'm not going to leave this school, but I'm still going to be here for them. So like, you have to look at that at both standpoints, because how would you feel? Would you have wanted to stay in that situation, do you think, or would you want to live in the all-black housing thing?
I would have wanted to live in that immediately, in that moment, I would have wanted the all-black housing. But you do raise an important point about it now being all-white housing, all-black housing. And I think that's when it becomes an institutional thing in terms of the college. Because I don't think all-white housing would be a bad thing as long as we're ensuring that our students are being educated in their classes, right? So there's a difference between having all-white housing of students who get oppression, right? Because you don't have to worry about any Nazi flags going up and any like transphobic messages going out there. Then if you have that, and that's all that's being fueled there, because I think we've had interesting experiences at Spring Hill, and so people always ask why we created MOCC, and they always assume that it was to segregate ourselves, and it was like, no, we're going to take this collective voice and put it in a mainstream Spring Hill experience, right? Because we do have different cultural backgrounds. We like different music. It's easier for black women, and I'm assuming, I'm not a black woman, I would assume it's easy for black women to share a bathroom with one another than it would be for a mixed group. And that seems stupid. People may say that's stupid, but why is that? That's a thing where, oh, Sydney been in the bathroom 30 minutes, I'm not tripping, I'm not gonna call my RA, I get it. I know what it's like to, you know, those subtle things that I prefer this type of music, I prefer this type of lifestyle, or I feel comfortable saying something, right? That because we make sacrifices for citizenship. And so W.E. Du Bois talks about double consciousness, and a sacrifice we make is, take a classroom here. If you've been the only black person in a classroom, haven't there been a moment where something black has come up and everybody kind of does this to you?
Right, exactly.
Yes. And so a sacrifice we make is not standing up and be like, I don't speak for all fucking black people. You know what I'm saying? So the sacrifice we make is we don't express what we really want, which is we're not all one. What do? We either answer and try to generalize it and address the fact that we don't speak for all black people in a polite or respectful way, or we alter the way we talk about race because we don't want people to feel uncomfortable, right? And so that's why I think the black housing wouldn't have been bad, because it's just easier, we have things in common. However, it could be a problem if even in that all black dorm, we're spilling anti-white rhetoric. It works the same way. So you have to make sure that the institution are giving people the tools to engage like you and I are at the moment. But it depends on, I really do think it depends on the school. And it depends on the student body and the student culture.
I feel like now we're living in a different time, which of course we are. Now people are getting really bold with their statements and their actions. So now they're taking the freedom of speech and actions, you know, to a new level. So they feel that, well, this is how I feel. I can say I can do it. I'm covered by this law, XOXO. But I mean, just because you have that, I mean, you can go through different ways of handling any kind of remarks that are being said, any type of actions. But I don't feel like there's really anything in place to stop it. So because all of this is happening now, they're just like, well, it wasn't a problem back then, so what do we have to do now? It'll fix itself. But now that we're having something in place now, that we're trying to make something, we're trying to stand for something, now everyone's getting wary and they're trying to shut it down. So I don't, well, with the black president, they're probably saying that because he's black that everything's fine and dandy, but you can clearly see that things aren't so fine and dandy. I don't know why everything is failing the way it is. I don't know where all this surge of energy is coming from, but just to turn on the TV and it be something happening every day. And now, sure, it's, now that this election is happening now, I feel like it's kind of shifting. So hopefully when someone's chosen, things can go back. But I don't know if it'll ever go back to being normal or being acceptable. Unless something, I feel like more laws or something like that is going to have to be taken place. And I feel like people who are well educated on what's actually going on need to be in leadership positions, because now I feel like everyone who is very educated on what's going on are lower down. And so they're not going to let us climb up to make a stand, make a change. But until we actually start ruffling their feathers, then that's when something will actually be taking place. And that's horrible to say, but I mean, it's the truth and someone has to say it. So I'm glad we're the people for the people. Change is coming. Change is here. Progression. Yeah. Everything that Jamal said had valid points. I loved how he referenced actual activists. So that really stuck with me as well.
Unfortunately, I think I was the only one who got their point across. I feel like I overtalked Kiara.
This dialogue really brought us together. So I feel like after this, we know more about each other and our beliefs. And I feel like that this didn't tear us apart in any way.
It reminded me that we all view similar things through different lenses. And so as someone who tries to embrace cognitive dissonance, it reminded me to just actively listen and to respect different perspectives.
I take away a newfound belief, a new friend, or a better friend. I also take away a stance on why I believe the things that I do, and I don't know, just I feel like a better person after this.
We found out that we had a lot in common. We view different oppressions the same way, or we understand things in similar ways, but just through different lenses and based on different experiences.
Before, I thought that I wouldn't have my voice heard, that it would be very hostile, but I feel like it was a very mutual ground, very common. I felt that we didn't try and overtalk one another. We gave everyone, we gave each other respect, which I really appreciated, and then I felt like we fed off of each other, so that was wonderful.
Yeah, I overtalked her.
I like having the broadcast. I like the situation that it put us in. I feel like having it like this, you're able to see everyone's point of view, why everyone does, how everyone thinks about this scenario. And just having it in any other way, I feel like would have been harmful. Maybe like your point couldn't have come across as clearly, but having it in this situation, I feel like it worked well.
Well, for future things like this, I'll remember to try to succinctly say what I want, but I'm always trying to be thorough. Like, I want people to understand me, and that's why I give examples or try to. So I just want to try to be a better listener and a better communicator, because I think these talks are important, and I think this is how we implement change.